the wonderfully loud white stripes there with I'm slowly turning into you. I think I can give this mic a bit more level there. Tell me if that's okay. Alright, yeah, Freeman Jack on PIR. Taking my ancestral home, the one that I used to occupy way back in the TNS days of Thursday night, 9 till 11, as was my manner in those days, as I will do today. I will give a disclaimer. My subject material is often of an extremely adult nature. Some of the opinions that I hold and ideas that I like to explore, not necessarily promote, can sometimes be troubling. Some people find them offensive. It's never my intention to offend. And certainly that intention extends to the wonderful admin and owners of PIR. So if I can ask that if anybody is troubled by what I'm saying, you have always got the option of the off button. I would prefer that you stayed with us and listened. If you are deeply offended, I would definitely much prefer that you came to me with that offence, because I hope that you will have only have taken offence in mistaking perhaps some point that I was making, because it would never be my intention to go out of my way to offend anybody. So there you go, there's my disclaimer. The opinions shared in tonight's program will in no way reflect the website or radio station's opinions or those of the members of the chat. Tonight's subject, and I will have to excuse myself. I realise that some people are very offended by smoking on air. I'm afraid that I'm a chronic anxiolic, just to extend that point, the sort of hour before going live any given week will be filled with essentially stage fright, dizzy, feeling sick, wishing that I wasn't doing it, quite knowing what I'm going to do, when I do it, etc., etc., etc. And my on-air nerves are not a great deal less. So I'm afraid that if you want me to do these radio shows, then I'm afraid that you're going to have to tolerate some of my foibles in order for me to conduct them. That said, tonight's subject, near-death experience. Trans-dimensional realities, non-ordinary realities, even time travel. In my formative years as a mechanic and an engineer and somebody working in heavy industry, was sold on the mechanistic, Newtonian, materialist view of reality and saw no particular reason to adjust those views in any way. I was, however, a lifelong temporal lobe epileptic and would experience the spectrum of epileptic seizures from sorry, there's somebody shouting on the stairs. It's the twin's birthday tonight, so expect disturbances. I'll do my best to edit the pod into some semblance of meaningful linearity, to which point I really should line up another tune just to fall back to in case there should be much knocking of the door and wagging of the dog's tail, etc., 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 etc. Yeah, so I had arrived into my mid-20s as a determined rationalist, as a determined materialist, as a confirmed atheist, and would often badger friends who tried to express express sort of concepts that fell outside of the rational, outside the norm, you know what I mean, the usual sort of ghosts, UFOs, you know what I mean, teleportation, transmigration of the soul, all these sort of things. Then my epilepsy worsened. One thing I do have to say on epilepsy is if you know anybody that suffers from any sort of fits, if they drink alcohol at all, certainly caution them to consider paying very close attention to if that may be the cause, and not to expect necessarily the imbibing to bring about the fits, because for me and for the nurse that finally cleared me of my worsening epilepsy through this understanding, both had to realise sort of on our own that it was the sobriety that brought about the fits, that because heavy drinkers go through a degree of detox whenever they sober up, that this is actually the convulsant sort of part of the drug action. Anyway, that aside, I didn't discover that for quite a few years later. But my fits began to worsen, and the duration and severity of the fits began to worsen to the point that I would often be completely wrenched out of normal reality and into some sort of alternate dimension. More often than not, to return with a fairly scrambled, unrecognisable impression as to where it was that I'd been. But occasionally, I'll be launched so utterly out of ordinary reality that I would actually not be aware that I was undergoing anything other than ordinary reality, and find the place that I landed in exactly like this, in an almost indistinguishable form. Where was I? Is that the dog settling? I don't know. Alright, temporal lobe epilepsy, yes. So during these bouts of fits and seizures, essentially the duration of the fit determines the depth of the experience, and beyond about 3 minutes, essentially you're in a heart fibrillation, so you're not what do they call it, arrhythmic, you're not pumping blood anymore, so effectively you've gone into a sort of suffocation type condition. And beyond about 3 minutes, essentially, you begin to experience a lot of the symptoms of sort of, I mean, the same sort of symptoms of sort of drowning and suffocation. And the most peculiar part of this was that, firstly, I began to have repeated what are in the sort of genre known as near-death experiences, where I would find myself in the sort of tunnel of consciousness, the maelstrom, and finding the sort of light above you and moving into the light, and finding yourself in the sort of plateau. I don't know what you would even call it. Some sort of I can see why the ancients would have placed it as the sort of top of some sort of cloud, because it does have that sort of quality about it. In some of mine, I was met by other characters. In others, I just found myself landed in there and sort of made my way home. And anyway, the issue with this being is that this sort of collection of experiences began to amass, and the Newtonian model didn't fit anymore, but I still desperately clung to it. It was my paradigm, and I based my entire kind of rationale, thinking and belief system around this Newtonian rationalist dualist model. And I came back from each of these experiences initially with exactly the same mindset. So I would arrive back from non-ordinary reality into the sort of stark grey of ordinary reality, and just think to myself, nah, that didn't happen. And repeatedly and convincingly and with conviction, I would entirely deny the experience of the transition, I suppose. And what appeared to happen was that the universe decided to prove its point. And so these experiences began to increase in frequency and increase in duration and increase in severity, leading up to the birth of my first boy in 92. And I had such a catastrophic fit in the toilets of the delivery rooms, next to the delivery rooms, that I found myself unconscious and head down a toilet bowl, cutting off the blood return to my head, and had the longest seizure. I actually don't know how long I was gone for. The estimates are up to 5 minutes. And only a few seconds of that would have been me walking from where I was into the toilets. Fortunately, I am here to tell you about it. My good friend, who is a nurse and sort of delivery mate to my partner at the time, happened to also be epileptic. And she realised that I was absent, thought that there was something slightly funny about it, and came and found me and basically revived me. But during that particular experience, I found myself once more in this plateau, in this sort of top of a cloudy land, whatever you want to call it. And I was confronted by no one other than myself, which was an extremely peculiar experience to find yourself having. I was absolutely and 100% myself. I wasn't in the myself that I was meeting. I certainly didn't experience any sort of sort of schizoid separation, although I have had experiences like that. It was a me. It was another me. It was outside of me. I found myself sort of prostrate on the floor at my own feet. And I was wagging a finger at myself and admonishing myself as to what on earth I had done to find myself in this place at this time when such important events were happening back where I'd left my body. And one of the peculiar experiences that seems to be common to these near-death experiences, I hear lots of other people report, is this sensation of such kind of bliss is the word that comes to mind, but I don't think it's a particularly adequate word, but a sense of well-being, perhaps, is a better word for it. The sense that nothing matters anymore when you arrive in these situations is actually a very inviting and I really suspect that we often actually face this choice, that in these sort of moments of life or death, that these are actually life choices presented in front of us. And I actually argued the toss with myself for quite some time, deciding that I actually preferred this sort of nice, warm, colourful, fluffy place to the toilet bowl that I kind of knew that my head was buried in somewhere back on Earth. Anyway, obviously I was very insistent and waggy-fingered and very sweary, and told myself that it wasn't my time and that I shouldn't be there and that I must go back at once. As was the same with all of these experiences, once I turned my mind back to my body, so it was literally just a matter of thinking about myself in the physical, and there wasn't the journey that one seems to take to arrive at that place in order to return. And usually the return is sort of the first gasp of air of your sort of reviving body, which is an extraordinary experience. And on that particular day, well, within about 10 minutes, my partner had delivered my Charlie, and having been dead a few minutes before and significantly dead and kind of so self-evidently dead from the experience that I'd undergone and the knowledge of what had been happening to my body at the time and the report of my friend who'd kind of rescued me, that I was in this unfathomably deep dichotomy of life and birth, life and rebirth, not only my own rebirth, but this birth of my firstborn son. And I don't really want to call it spiritual, because it wasn't a spiritual significance. It was an esoteric significance. It was a non-materialist significance. And I think that possibly just because of the sort of heightened emotional state of the circumstances at the time, it really didn't sink in. It really didn't sink in, you know what I mean? You would think that something like that would have such a monumental effect over, you know what I mean, impact on your mind after that date, but it just didn't happen. I don't know whether it's, you know what I mean, having the newborn son, bringing him home to a caravan, you know what I mean, dealing with all the evictions and stuff that came very shortly thereafter. I suppose life just got in the way. And before long, it's a, you know what I mean, a few months down the line, 6 months, 10 months down the line, and lo, I'm having yet another, interruptions once more. Having yet another multi-minute fit and finding myself launched from this reality, only this time not to find myself in some sort of mythological afterlife, but merely to have apparently flitted to some other reality, some other situation that was more or less indistinguishable from the one that I was in. And often the transition would be so fast that it would be a matter of sort of shaking your head as if you'd just woken from a dream when you arrived in the new place, because you couldn't really remember how you'd arrived there or the travelling to get there or why you should be there, but you realised that you were no longer where you were, and there was no real sense of having anything happened in between. It was almost like the switching of channels on a television set. And these experiences were just extraordinary. I mean, I would find myself in completely other places and apparently completely other times, sometimes in other forms. I once had one where I was just sitting in the armchair of my chair and then found myself looking out through the eyes of what appeared to be some sort of a dog. And I was still presently aware that I was myself and convinced that I still had my human frailties and inabilities compared to a dog, only to find myself innately surprised when this dog thing that I was looking out through the eyes of was able to do dog things, because I was, I mean, wincing seeing branches coming towards me, only to turn so quickly away from them that it wasn't even a problem. And I think, wow, God, I missed that branch. And it was a real mystery to me. Another bizarre thing about that particular experience was, at the time, night vision goggles were around, but the only ones that could be manufactured were the green ones, the ones that had the sort of green sort of LED effect. And I remember in the experience being struck by the fact that my vision was more or less black and white, but it wasn't black and white. It was some sort of a red and black, a sort of red and black grayscale. And it struck me while I'm having the experience that this looks a lot like sort of night vision, and it was a night scene at the time. Yeah, I really hate you at times, Michael.
Sorry.
Yes, you will be. Can somebody come through the radio and kill him now? I don't care if it's his birthday. He's not getting a day off. Jesus, I honestly don't think there's been a single show that I've ever done that that boy hasn't interrupted. None of the others. I mean, there's four children. Was four children. I can't exactly call that a child anymore. No, it's behaviour. My God. Where was I? That just completely blew my thread, Michael. Thank you so much. Oh, God, he does it every time. See, sometimes you don't even know about this. Sometimes he just opens the door, peers around it, and just does something to distract me without it actually making a sound. So you'll be listening away on air and thinking that I'm sounding like a stumbling idiot, when in fact I've got some gurning loon leaning around the door trying to distract me. Ah, children. Can't eat a whole one. Oh, Jesus wept. Where the hell was I? Excuse me. I really don't want to have to resort to a tune. I think you're just going to have to sit there and listen to me ruminating, because I always do this. He puts me off and then I have to go to a tune. And by the time I come back from the tune, when I listen back to the podcast, I'm nowhere near the point that I was actually trying to make, because my brain's moved on too many minutes ahead of myself. Damn it. This is Freeman Jack on People's Internet Radio. I think it might be. Welcome to my world. Infrared vision. So, and it wasn't until several years later, when the red scale infrared sort of night vision glasses came out, that I was suddenly reminded of having this experience. When again, I'd come back from that experience and just gone, did I just see through a dog's eye? That one possibly only lasted 30 seconds. I don't even know if I had a grey male fit. I think that may have just been an absence. Because this was the other thing as well, was during all of these grey male seizures, absences just became... That's just when you sort of disappear for a little while. You know what I mean? You'll be in mid-conversation with a friend, and they'll think that you've nodded off or gone a bit vacant. And what you've actually done is you've left your body momentarily. I would often find myself doing this in mid-conversation, going to one of these sort of non-ordinary reality places. And coming back and them still hanging on the last word of mine, expecting me to complete a sentence. Because it had only been a matter of a few seconds. And so what could just be a brief pause in a conversation would actually be me leaving my body, going to some other dimension, experiencing some non-ordinary reality experience, and then coming back to the room. Oh, for God's sakes. I am going to have to put a tune on, because I'm going to have to kill him. Infanticide. Does that count at 19? Is it still infanticide at 19? I'm not sure that it is infanticide at 19, but certainly... no, patricide is when you kill your dad, isn't it? It is infanticide. Oh, well, whatever. Yes, my musings on infanticide of a higher order. I didn't kill him, by the way, just to make that clear. You know, I don't generally go around killing my children, regardless of how they behave. Right, okay, so the point that I was at was that I'm now finding myself liberally falling in and out of, let's just call them realities, because to me, at the time, they were as real as this experience is now. In fact, as far as memories go, the memories of these experiences have this strange, visceral quality. They're almost holographic in nature, and they don't seem to dim, fade, or become corrupted with memory or with retelling. I can absolutely assure you that the descriptions of the experiences as I describe them to you today are precisely as I would have described them 25 years ago when they were happening. So, I'm still repeatedly having these extended fits and near-death experiences of one magnitude order or another, and having these absences. Like I say, I don't know whether the kind of dog eyes thing was an absence or an actual seizure, but the next experience was an absence, and it was just like I was describing. I was sat in my own settee in my home, chatting to a friend on my other settee, in just general moderate conversation about something not in particularly important, and suddenly I'm no longer in my caravan in the woods chatting to my friend. I'm now in a telephone box, and moreover, it's not a very pleasant telephone box. It's one of those old, you know, the old red GPO telephone boxes with the rectangular glass and the cast iron frame and all that, and the old Bakelite handset with the 2p and the 10p slot. And I'm so in this experience, I can even pretty much smell the pee, you know, because all those old telephone boxes always used to smell like a urinal, you know what I mean? And moreover, I've got a soft Irish accent, and I appear to be speaking some sort of, I kind of guessed that it must have been some sort of code word, but I really didn't. I said this word down the receiver. I had the receiver handset in my, the handset in my hand, and I spoke into the mouth, spoke this word into the mouthpiece, and as it came out of me, in this soft Irish accent, and appeared to be some really unusual word. It just struck me as just completely uncommon. I wish I could remember what it was. And anyway, the next minute, this all hell broke loose. The windows were all shattered on the phone box, and some sort of explosion has taken place nearby. And the next second, I'm back in my armchair. My mate sitting there looking at me expectantly, wondering when I'm going to finish my sentence. And I'm sort of, And again, I was such a bloody rationalist. I couldn't even admit it to my friend who was sitting there with me at the time. I couldn't say where I'd just been or what had just happened. It was the same thing again. I came back and I went, nah. And moreover, at the time, all of the sort of Irish bombing campaigns had pretty much died out about, well, certainly the mainland bombing campaigns had all died out about 5 years previously, so it wasn't even anything that was sort of current or in the news or now. And so I'm forced to the conclusion that if this was an actual experience, if this was an actual out of body, trans body, transmigration of the soul's metempsychosis experience, where I literally experienced what was happening to somebody else at some other time, then it must have been at some other time, that it must have been at some historic date. And still, I wouldn't have it. There was no way that I was acknowledging that this experience could have any connection to any reality. And one of the things that I used to most clearly kind of dismiss this to my rationalist self was that I'd noticed that instead of an explosion, that apart from the glass shattering in the phone box, that there appeared to be like a slump. It was almost like the roofs of the houses kind of sloughed off the roofs and sort of poured into the streets, almost like a fluid. And so I just dismissed this as some kind of sort of daydream, fantasy, whatever, until many, many, many months later, I was watching TV on my little sort of 12-volt telly that I had in my caravan, and they're doing some sort of historic perspective of the Northern Ireland Troubles, and there's a scene that looks to all the bloody world like it's a few feet away from this bloody phone box that I remember standing in, the car in the middle of the scene looked exactly the same. I swear I remember it was like a white cortina or something. The buildings looked exactly the same, little kind of tile roofed bungalows. And this bloody bomb went off, and what happens? These bloody roof tiles slough off this roof like a bloody avalanche, like some sort of fluid. And I'm left there staring at the television with my jaw dropping, and this holographic realization, you know what I mean, this visceral memory of this non-ordinary event sort of suddenly keying in to some new paradigm. Yeah, again, you know what I mean, come away from this just going, nah, that just can't be right. That's just... And so it persisted in happening. And the events got more and more frequent and more bizarre. I found myself in what appears to be some sort of an Iron Age settlement, looking out through the sort of entrance to my yurt. I would often flip through sort of timescales when I was driving or walking through the lanes around Kent. I would really be filled with this sense that I really wasn't too sure what century I was in at any given moment, and the sense of sort of time distortion was prescient on me. Anyway, the conclusive episode in this voyage, for me anyway, that finally broke my Newtonian rationalism was an experience when I had a really major seizure, apparently from the people that were in the room. I was like diagonal across the top and bottom edges of a settee, rigid as a plank and ashen white for what appeared to be more than 3 minutes. And during this 3 minutes, I didn't go very far. In fact, I went so not very far in sort of physical location that I found myself walking up the street only a few yards from the house that this all was happening in. And so obviously I didn't find anything particularly peculiar about this. I didn't remember how I'd left the house. I didn't remember saying goodbye to my friends. I didn't remember closing the door. I didn't remember getting the 20 or 30 yards up the hill that I'd got. But on finding myself walking up the hill, I didn't find anything particularly unusual or extraordinary in this experience. So I carry about my business, assuming that I must have intended on leaving my friends and intended on leaving and coming this way. And despite it being the opposite way to going home, I thought that maybe I must have had some reason for coming this way. So I might as well continue until I could work out why I'd left theirs and why I'd come this way. I had friends in that direction. I thought perhaps I was going there. There was an off license in that direction. I thought perhaps I was going to the off license. So nothing particularly peculiar. And as I'm walking up the road, the first thing I notice is that the scene appears to be kind of sparkly, a bit sort of like a hoarfrost had come down. Now, being that this was kind of mid-September and the nights were still quite warm, that was fairly uncommon even in the dark woods of Kent. And the next thing that I noticed was that the air was really kind of thick and hard to breathe, and that the noises of the sort of countryside and of the roads and the likes were all really muffled and seemed very distant. And I began to get the impression that it was like a fog had come in, maybe a sea fog, and that maybe that was, you know what I mean, what had left sort of dewdrops and all the tree leaves and on the surface of the road that was making it kind of a bit sparkly. And I have to point out here that my eyesight is not great, and I'll often be walking around in a bit of a myopic fog, a bit Mr. Magooey. And so often I'll not notice things that would appear very self-evident to other people at the initial viewing. And I began to notice that the sparkling coming off the road surface wasn't from a hoarfrost, but it was in fact the glistening off of the surfaces of cobblestones. And because I hadn't been made aware of the extraordinary circumstances that I appeared to be experiencing, I presumed that I must have simply not noticed that the local council had removed the tarmac and had returned the road to a cobbled surface, and that somehow they had done it in some effort to gentrify it and to sort of oldie-worldie the village a bit more than it already was. This is Lambrest in Kent, which is pretty oldie-worldie anyway. And the next thought through my head was, oh my God, that's going to be a nightmare to drive come winter, because cobblestones are dangerous enough, let alone when they're icy and coming down a hilly sort of S-bend. So these thoughts were going through my head, and I'm continuing to walk up the road, and as I get a bit further up the road, I notice the light cast out of a window onto the pavement, and how sort of it was very yellow and didn't look very much like a sort of electric light. And I noticed that it was coming from the pub, and this particular pub is one of the really old buildings in Lambrest, and it's so old that it's sunk below the level of the footpath. So the sort of the front room window, the front window of the building, is only a little above sort of pavement level. So as I'm walking along the pavement, I can kind of see into the sort of snug bar at this pub. And I can see that it's all lit up with candles, and they're all sort of dressed in smocks and drinking out of double-handed mugs. I think, oh, for God's sakes, that's why they're having a folk night down the pub. Only in Lambrest could they do a full fancy dress folk night. Kept on walking. And I get a little further on, and I notice a yew tree in the front garden of this large house, this large Georgian four-square house. And I make a note to myself again, I mean, no wonder people write me off as a bloody loony. At the time, I was making a yew tree map of Kent, and I was renowned for constantly having my yew tree, my plotted map tucked in my back pocket, and a measuring tape in my pocket at all times, and would be known for screeching to a halt while driving down major roads to jump out and measure and plot the position of a particular yew tree if I saw it. And I remember walking past this yew tree and noticing it and thinking, oh God, I'm surprised I hadn't noticed that one before. Not got my map on me. Must make a mental note to self. Remember, next time I got my map in my tape measure in my pocket, take that particular yew tree's dimensions and plot it on my map. And very briefly after this point, I've returned to my bloody body in the living room with my friends coming out of the fit, and suddenly am painfully aware that wherever I've just been, I've been there for a significant enough length of time to experience walking abroad in it. Enough time to have a number of sort of awarenesses about it without realizing the reality of the situation, and the dawning of realization that this may have been something very different to what I thought I had just been experiencing. Anyway, on returning to my poor terrified friends, who thought had become by this point absolutely convinced that I had actually died, and were worrying about whether they should call the ambulance, the police, or possibly the morgue. Luckily they didn't either. I, as usual, returned my body in reasonably fit health. It's never a particularly pleasant place to be, back into a body that's just gone through a temporal lobe fit. Your body just tears itself apart while you're away. All that flailing about and that, biting bits out of yourself and stuff, so... But anyway, not only were these poor people absolutely terrified, but on talking to them on the next day about it, they utterly denied that the thing had ever happened. So I'm stuck in this situation of being faced with having this most potent experience of my entire goddamn life. And the friends who had been partial witnesses to it, at least, just simply in complete denial about what had happened the previous evening. I don't know whether they thought that somehow that maybe they were protecting me from myself by not admitting to how scary it had all been. Anyway, again, this got filed in the nah camp, as it was just to begin to incorporate that into any sort of meaningful sense of how you relate to the world as it is was just completely beyond me. I don't know whether it would be in anybody else's capability, but it was certainly beyond me. And so again, it got consigned to this weird box in the back of my head where all this sort of weird stuff got locked up and not allowed out again because it was scary and disorientating. And I find myself walking up the high street in the, funnily enough, in the same direction as I had in that experience at some later date a few months later. And lo, I have my U-tree map in my back pocket and my tape measure in my front pocket, and walk past this U-tree and go, it's that U-tree I meant to measure. Bumble across the road, oblivious to what's about to happen, and find myself at the wall, at a garden wall with this U-tree a significant distance away from the wall on the other side, and would normally have just hopped over and take my measurement and hopped back again. But it just so happened that the garden, the owner of the garden, was in the garden mowing his lawn at the time. And it was this vicar. And so I thought, well, I can't just like hop over this chap's garden in front of him and wrap a tape measure around his tree and then hop back and just wander off. It might kind of worry him. I might, you know, I don't know, I just thought it was polite to at least ask if I could measure his yew tree. So I call him over to the wall and tell him about, you know, my yew tree map and how I was mapping all of the yew trees, all the significant yew trees in Kent and East Sussex, and showed him the map. And we get chatting about his garden and about his yew tree, and I'm commenting on how fine a yew tree it is. And I noticed that for a, it was a significant girth, and a yew tree of that size is of a significant age. Yew trees grow incredibly slowly. If you see a big English Irish yew, then you can pretty much assume that you're in the hundreds, if not thousands of years sort of range. This one probably was significantly less than 500 years old, but in that sort of region, sort of 200 to 500 years old. And I commented that it was a fine yew tree to be sat in the garden of such a moderate looking sort of 1950s built bungalow. And the vicar agreed that it was a magnificent tree to be in the garden of such a moderate bungalow, and pointed out that it had actually originally been in the grounds of the old rectory, and went on to explain that this rectory had burnt down in the 1890s before the demolition and construction of the council estate, the cul-de-sac that was there in its place now. And I stopped him in his tracks and said, hold on a minute, can I describe what the old vicarage looked like to you? And he looked at me a little incredulously and said, well, I don't think that's very likely. As far as I'm aware, I'm the only person with a record of it. I've got when I first moved into this bungalow, there was an old photograph from the time of the vicarage, and it's in my loft in a box. And as far as I know, there's no other pictures in the sort of public record of it. And so I said, well, I think I can still tell you what it looks like. I went on to describe this four square white Georgian house with the four windows and the big bay door and the Grecian arch over the top. And he nearly went white and said, well, yeah, that's exactly what it looked like. How on earth do you know? And suddenly I realise where it is that I know this from. And it was from this experience. And then suddenly I go a bit white as well. And kind of, it would be really hard to tell you that right now. And kind of wander off a little bit dazed from the experience. And really that was the nail in the coffin. You know what I mean? You can't come away from subjective experience like that still holding on to any sort of paradigm that the universe is somehow some sort of a clockwork machine, and that reality is simply all that we experience in ordinary consensus reality, that there appear to be boundaries and territories that are not part of ordinary reality. Sometimes they're sort of the realms of the mystic, sometimes, like me, they're the realms of disease or disorder. But I think the fact that these places seem to have some sort of a collective reality, in as much as lots of people report them in very similar ways, which I'm going to go on to. I've got a wonderful little piece by Hamish Miller, who's recently died, but an old thing of his from 2011, where he describes a near-death experience, and the near-death experience that he describes, as I'm going to go on to describe, is not only very remarkable in its detail and in its specificity, but it's also almost identical to something that I experienced. So I think, as a by way of moving on and to give your poor ears a rest, let's find something pleasant to fill your ears with while I line up. For God's sakes, what's his name again? Hamish Miller. What we got here? Oh yeah, I'm gonna go with that. Bit of Brian Eno. Here we go. Back on the other side of 4 minutes.
In his 50s, Hamish was an award-winning entrepreneur running his own furniture-making business, but his life changed abruptly when he was taken into hospital for emergency surgery.
The first thing I was aware of later on was looking up and seeing the surgeon and hearing him say, "Pity you were too late, chaps." And he took off his mask and went off. And I was a bit concerned because I had all my faculties were still there. And then I became aware that I wasn't looking at the surgeon from the operating table, that I was way above looking down, and he was chatting, and they were closing the place out and putting lights out and all that sort of thing. And I had this incredible experience of moving up into a misty sort of area, and then becoming aware that I was in a tunnel. And it was totally peaceful. It was a place of absolute compassion, of understanding, of no coercion to do anything at all. And I became aware actually that I wasn't me. I was a long tube with rounded ends, and I was, this tunnel started to form around the mist. And as soon as I was aware of that, the tube started to move up the tunnel. There was a vague light at the end. And it came to rest just at the end of the tunnel. And I got out. I was no longer the tube. I was a sort of virtual baby in nappies, if you like, a symbol of total innocence, but completely without fear and very curious about the light. And then this experience, it starts getting trite because I didn't really have the language to describe it. But I got out and I went into this area of lighter area, which was sort of floored like alabaster marble and vague colours and movements of And there were beings, not that I could see, but that I was aware of. And they were completely compassionate, loving, incredibly caring beings. And they said, this is the entrance to, the wording is difficult here, the entrance to the level of life, if you like. These are our concepts, and these are some of our concepts. And if you feel that you if you can contribute to them, or even if you can understand them, you're welcome to come in. But they actually gave me all the experiences of all my lifetimes to make the decision whether to come in. And I looked at these concepts, and frankly, I didn't understand them. I thought, I just don't know enough. And I said to these, not said, but communicated to these amazing beings, I think I ought to go back. And then I was aware, for the first time, of the huge humour that's in the universe, and there was a sort of chuckle of appreciation. And the voices in unison said, "We think you should." So I did. I got back into the tube and went hurtling down the tunnel, knowing that at the end of it, and the visual thing was shards of glass that I was going to have to go through and pain. And in the event, I just went through with no pain at all. And the next thing I knew was a voice saying, shouting, "Mr. Miller, are you in there?" And I wanted to communicate all this to where I'd been and what had happened, what a wonderful thing it was. So, having come back into my body, I came back with a completely new set of values. All the values I'd had before, all the important things that I seemed to be doing before were just a nonsense. And I was just so glad to be alive and be able, capable of appreciating what we have here, of sounds and people and colours and flowers and growing things. And it was a fundamentally life-changing experience. And the other big thing is I came back completely without fear of anything, because once you're not afraid of death, there's not much point in being afraid of anything else. And I decided that what I was doing was not very satisfying, so I came down to Cornwall and down here, because I knew there was something down. I'd been pulled down here for years. Very shortly after I moved down here, there's a clairvoyant walked around the corner. I didn't know who he was. And he stopped and he looked at me and he said, "Are you involved in healing?" And I said, "No, I didn't know what healing was." And he said, "Well, you should be." And he said, he talked about healing and the National Federation and the way people can be healed. And I thought, this is a real nutter. And he said, "Well, come up the hill, walk up the hill." And we walked up to the top of Trent Cromhill, and he said, "You ought to be involved in healing people," but he said, "You have to be involved with healing the earth." And I backed off a bit, and I thought, well, you know, who is this guy, and what is this about? And he said, the earth energy center of this hill is here.
Jesus. Literally seconds before coming back on air. Yeah, now shut up and go away. Michael was just quite happy with hearing himself described as my version of fingernails on glass. He thought that was quite an appropriate description of how he is to me. God, I adore him, but oh Jesus, has he been hard work. 19 bloody years of, his hard work before he bloody born that child. Anyway, where was I? Yeah, so that was, let me just push this door closed. Just cry in a few minutes' time. Hey, dear. That was, oh, for God's sake, this door ain't gonna rattle up there. Jesus, man. How's any genius supposed to survive around here? That's a joke, by the way. sakes. It is just like, could you be any noisier if you tried to know if all that's coming over on the mic, but man alive. And it's like the bloody Waltons at the minute. Can we say our good nights and shut up? I'm getting good today. I'm not shouting or anything. No elevated voices. Right, okay. They're still bloody going. Hamish Miller. The experience that he just described there, I don't know really if you caught it. It's really only a very sort of brief few sentences of that experience. But when he talks about being shown the plan, the designs, he's obviously describing seeing some physical object which contained these. When you finished rearranging your lips, dear. Dog making slurping noises, not me. I'm about to make slurping noises. This show runs on copious amounts of tea and constant nicotine. Where was I? Yes, the plan, this concept of our work, I think he describes it, and this identically mimics something that I had in an absence where I appeared to be presented. I can't say I was given it. I was aware of suddenly sort of having it in my lap, my virtual lap, because this wasn't in any sense a sort of hallucination in ordinary reality. This was another absence and stepping out of ordinary reality. But the me that wasn't any longer in my body was offered this heavy-bound tomb with what looked like sort of iron hinges and a big clasp on it and sort of leather-bound, thick, heavy book. And for me, I seem to remember, this one I'm not entirely so clear on, but I seem to remember, again, being told this is our work and being invited to take a look and to see if I understood it. And I remember opening this book and being presented with what looked to my eyes like some sort of shorthand Egyptian hieroglyphs. In some respects, having recently done a lot of work in quantum physics, they may possibly have actually have been a lot of the sort of types of symbol that are used in physics, perhaps, but to my mind at the time they looked kind of hieroglyphic in their, or glyph-like in their form. And again, like I say, I have this appalling eyesight, and this appalling eyesight appears to follow me into these non-ordinary realms. And I remember looking at this book and seeing all of this kind of gibberish hieroglyphics on the page. And it was a bit like an illuminated, it looked a bit like an illuminated text. It looked like sort of the print was sort of, I don't know, touched in with gold leaf or something. It looked very, very sparkly and almost translucent. And I remember sort of carefully sort of homing in on a particular part of the page and trying to make sense of what it was I was looking at. And as I'm looking at a particular point on the page, I notice that these sort of glyphs or symbols or whatever they were aren't staying still. They're not staying the same. So the letters on the pages kept shuffling and rearranging themselves. And I remember at this point just thinking, how on earth are you supposed to read this stuff? You know what I mean? How am I supposed to understand this? I can't even tell what the thing is. What is this stuff? And at this point, I was sort of shrugged my shoulders and sort of, much like Hamish, said, no, I don't think I can help you guys, sort of thing. And the book has sort of closed with a big thud. And much like him, there was this sort of, I wouldn't exactly say booming laugh, but a deep, warm, familial laugh from a number of sort of disambiguated bodiless figures from somewhere behind me, and I found myself back in the chair. And much like Hamish, I had somebody also who presented themselves to me and recognised some parts of the experiences that I was going through as significant, and directed me towards diverting my energies towards healing, the healing arts. And at the time, it was just so beyond my paradigm that I just simply didn't encompass it. And it's only been in more recent years that I've began to work with that side of what appears to be happening to me. And in many respects, I've had some very interesting and intriguing results in that particular respect. Okay, one other place that I just want to go before sort of rounding things off is Buckminster Fuller. Buckminster Fuller is a great hero of mine, and there's a part of his life story that many aren't familiar with. They'll know him for his geodesic dome and perhaps for Buckminster Fullerene, the buckyballs, the carbon 60 that I parade in my avatars everywhere. But in his early career, he didn't really have an easy time of it at all. He was living in more or less abject poverty in the burgeoning 1930s depression, and with a large family, a large young family to support, and not very many resources. Anyway, in the Wikipedia for Buckminster Fuller, you'll find a section titled Depression and Epiphany. Excuse me while I read from Wiki. Buckminster Fuller recalled 1927 as a pivotal year of his life. His daughter Alexandra had died in 1922 of complications from polio and spinal meningitis just prior to her fourth birthday. Fuller dwelled on her death, suspecting that it was connected with the Fuller's damp and drafty living conditions. This provided motivation for Fuller's involvement in Stockade Building Systems, a business which aimed to provide affordable, efficient housing. In 1927, Fuller, then aged 32, lost his job as president of Stockade. The Fuller family had no savings to fall back on, and the birth of their daughter Allegra in 1927 added to the financial challenges. Fuller was drinking heavily and reflecting upon the solution to his family struggles on long walks around Chicago. During the autumn of 1927, Fuller contemplated suicide so that his family could benefit from a life insurance payment. Fuller said that he had experienced a profound incident which would provide direction and purpose for his life. He felt as though he was suspended several feet above the ground, enclosed in a white sphere of light. A voice spoke directly to Fuller and declared, "From now on, you need never await temporal attestation to your thought. You think the truth. You do not have the right to eliminate yourself. You do not belong to you. You belong to the universe. Your significance will remain forever obscure to you, but you may assume that you are fulfilling your role if you apply yourself to converting your experiences to the highest advantage of others." Fuller stated that this experience led to a profound re-examination of his life. He ultimately chose to embark on an experiment to find out what a single individual could contribute to changing the world and benefiting all humanity. Fuller actually went on to never take a wage in his entire life. He would be paid fees for appearing at places, and some of his businesses made money, which he drew down an allowance from, but yeah, he actually lived out the rest of his life according to the principles that came in that particular revelation. Excuse me. Oh, should I have set him up? If you listen very carefully in the background, we now have the accompaniment of the South East London Police Helicopter Orchestra. They're probably looking out for the other twin. The significance of that particular story to me being that while I didn't have the accommodating, informative, disembodied voice to educate me about the experience, I had an almost identical epiphany like experience where I too found myself apparently emblazoned with light, spread eagled, left flat on my back, on sprawled on my bed in the middle of the day. It struck suddenly and it felt like it went on for about half an hour, certainly sort of 20 minutes. And during this time, I had the intense sensation of feeling like I was illuminated from within, that I had effectively become star-like. Again, very difficult experience to quantify or qualify in any meaningful sense. So, as the hour is approaching, in summation, I have still yet to reach any conclusion about what these experiences have amounted to and just how seriously to incorporate them into any sort of rational paradigm that I need to formulate. However, I find that they do leave me with some inescapable questions about the description of reality as it's given to us, the collective description of reality. And that, while maintaining, hopefully, a semblance of my previous sort of fundamental rationalist rationality, that I'm able somehow to straddle these sort of two worlds and to see somehow beyond the See, this is the thing. I think that the reason why I settled on the terms ordinary and non-ordinary reality, they're taken from Castaneda, who I think plagiarized them from somebody else previously, is because that more or less sums up the experience, because the experience to the experiencer feels ordinary at the time. There's nothing particularly extraordinary about the sensation of the experience to let you know that this is something untoward or something other that's happening at the time. That, like I say, it appears to be possible to flit in and out of these experiences, and I've often been brought to wonder if perhaps this is even what sort of daydreaming can be like, because some people have described their sort of daydreams as very sort of hyper-real. I wonder if perhaps this is in the basis of things, descriptions like astral projection, remote viewing. All of these become something that possibly has a mechanism that is similar to all of them. It certainly raises some very serious questions about what consciousness actually consists of. And like Hamish, the one thing that I came away from these experiences with was, like I said, from the NDE on the birth of my first son, of being patently aware that I appear to have a time, and that time wasn't there or then, and one would assume that it isn't here or now, and that it will be sometime in the future, but when it is, will be that time. And as a consequence, I have absolutely no fear of death. I have almost no fear of infirmity. I'm aware that consciousness will out, and that our perception of discomfort and of pain and of anguish is one of only perceiving the front piece of the depth of reality, that the reality that's the consensus reality that we all exist in appears to be a hybrid reality with something that underlies it, some substrate of reality that underlies it. And I think that substrate of reality has some fairly extraordinary dimensions that we've still yet to fully explore as a people. Anyway, that's kind of time travel, non-ordinary reality, near-death experience, epilepsy, all wrapped up in a bow. I really am not entirely sure where that leaves me or leaves any researchers into these sort of subjects. Like I say, my feelings after all of these years are still broadly inconclusive. I'm describing this as historical. I mean, I rarely am troubled by fits these days, but if I do fit, then I am still launched into some sort of non-ordinary reality. Fortunately, hugely infrequently these days. I can't say that any of those experiences have been anything like as dramatic as those that I was experiencing through the 90s. So it's not necessarily quite what it seems. And one of the things that all of these experiences that has left me with is a profound sense that perhaps the reality that we experience is actually a much broader, much more broadly under our individual control and our individual perception than necessarily the collective reality that we appear to feel we can't. There's sort of no rational escaping from. Certainly, in recent years, I've found that I've been able to adjust my reference of reality, my reality tunnel, and really tune it to my own desire. And it's left me with some fairly odd perspectives on some matters, but that's where I'm at, and I can't deny it. You've been presented with much of the substance of that which prevents me from denying the subjective experience of my own reality. So if you want to come on a voyage with me, come back this time next week for some more of the same. I think possibly bifurcation next week. I think I might actually do why individual sovereignty needs to be expressed more carefully than somehow it is currently. Been getting a lot of people reporting, getting into a lot of trouble with some of the approaches that are being expressed in various forums and in various sort of radio shows, and I just feel it's incumbent on me to discuss some of those issues. They are prescient. Anyway, finish it off with some corner shop. Gonna be covering me Omniversity slot after the hour, so it'll be tunes till the hour. I'm not sure whether I'll even bother coming to the mic. I've got a recording lined up, which is a fabulous illustrative example of how the meta-analysis of the data sets that are available to us in this sort of modern era have enabled us to view biology and natural systems in completely new and new ways that haven't been possible before. And this is to my mind anyway, a really significant step forward in our ability to understand ourselves and our place in the world. Anyway, thank you for listening. Thank you for putting up with me. I'll be back, same place, same time next week. And here's some corner shop.
Brother, it's in the drums.